The leftists love to say that everybody is a mongrel. Everybody is descended from immigrants. We're all the same. Of course, it isn't true. The white people of Britain and Europe are, for the most part, native, indigenous, and aboriginal. There has been some movement of population about from one bit to another, but this is all quite modest, and the people involved have been quite closely related in the first place. Around 1,000 years ago, some people from Scandinavia landed in what is now Normandy, in France. They were Nordic people, warriors. They came across the sea and did what Nordic warriors often do. They pillaged and raped and set up home. They took local women for their wives, and they did rather well for themselves. There was a new culture which grew up, Norman culture. This was the warrior ways of the men from the north, with the language and much of the culture of northern France. 2 generations later, a fleet of these warriors invaded England, led by William the Bastard, who, after a bit of good fortune in battle, liked to be known as William the Conqueror. England was, at that time, the richest land in Europe, which is hardly surprising, is it? William was no immigrant. He wasn't welcome in England. He was bitterly resented, especially by the people whose noses he most put out of joint, namely, the last bunch of Nordic warriors to come across the sea and carve themselves out a slice of England and make the populace work for them, the Saxons. These people were invaders from northern Europe. Saxony is in eastern Germany. People had come from all along the northern European and Scandinavian coasts, from Norway through to Belgium at various times. Once ships were invented, Viking was inevitable. We see Viking as a noun, but really, it's a verb. It's an obvious strategy. Fill your ship with big, strong, heavily armed men, leave your women and children at home, and go and attack some farmers or monasteries over the seas. The advantage is always going to be with the attackers. Farmers work the land. By definition, they're not all going to be crowded together in large numbers. They're going to be spread out, surrounded by the land they farm, and they also have their wealth gathered together in one place, and their women and children are nearby. Of course, the advantage is with the attackers, whose own wealth, women and children are hundreds of miles away. If you turn up with 30 men with swords, you can easily take a village of 100 people, using the element of surprise and your prey's vulnerability to fire and rape and mindless violence. Farmers often owned weapons, but they couldn't be carrying them around with them at all times. These people who came across the seas were not immigrants. They were not welcome. They came to conquer and usurp. They saw the wealth the land produced, and they wanted to take it. DNA evidence and language evidence are slightly at odds here. The archaeological evidence, the evidence of change of culture and the change of language, and the introduction of new words and place names led historians to believe that the history of England was one of great slaughter and population replacement, but the DNA evidence suggests otherwise. There is far less difference in the DNA between the Irish, Scots, Welsh, and English than you might imagine. Of course, there is more continental northern European blood in the English. They did see more conquests. There was, after all, more to steal here. But the majority of the DNA of all the people of the British Isles shows strong continuity. There is plenty of ancient British blood in the English. The idea that the Welsh are the true inhabitants of England is not supported by the DNA evidence. Most people from Ireland, England, Scotland, and Wales all show similar and common genetic descent, a common ancestry which is far older than an identified culture such as that of the Celts. There is no evidence that the English are a peculiarly mongrel race. There is non-native blood in the Scots and the Irish too. We are all a bit mixed, but even the English are mostly native. Immigration into Britain is a new thing. In the past, people crossed the sea and came to trade and to usurp and to conquer. There were very few immigrants. An immigrant is somebody who comes in to join in a society and an economy from elsewhere. There was always a small flow of intellectuals who could move from one country to another, helped by the common link of Christianity and the universal language of study, which was Latin. This represented a tiny handful of people, too few for anybody to ever have a problem with. These were foreigners, but they were white and Christian, and they did what they could to fit in rather than stand out. There were also a few Jews. Few, indeed, mere dozens in a population of millions. Once England started to open up to the world, there were also a few people from further afield, a few blacks, Indians, and Native Americans, but these numbers were absolutely tiny. They were mostly a kind of status symbol for people who wished to appear something special, exotic servants. The mass migration of non-white people did not happen until the modern era. Modern immigration is all about going to seek your fortune in a country with more opportunities than the one you belong in. That is quite different to what happened in America before the last couple of decades of the 19th century. The people who went to America before this time were not immigrants in the modern sense. They were pioneers. There is a big difference between an immigrant and a pioneer. A modern immigrant goes to live in a country which is already developed to a level far in excess of the land he leaves. What has that in common with the Pilgrim Fathers? What did they expect to find when they arrived in the Americas? A coastline that had been barely mapped. No cities, no towns, no jobs, no shops, no streets, no welfare, no welcoming committee. They didn't even have diversity officers to smooth their way. The same is true of the people who went to Australia, at least those who chose to go. They left civilization and prosperity behind, and they had nothing but potential and opportunity to find. How can you possibly compare people who crossed the oceans in sailing ships to face the prospect of making their home after they first built it with somebody who treks across a few miles of poorly patrolled borderland with plans to find accommodation, work, and wealth in a big city? They are not the same kind of people at all. Pioneers are not the same as economic migrants. It is insulting to the descendants of pioneers to compare them to today's opportunist economic migrants. It is also insulting to the native people of Britain to say that they are descended from immigrants. No, they're not. Only a small number are. Most of their ancestors were the aboriginal people of these islands. Some have the blood of invaders in their veins. People who did not pass through immigration control at Heathrow Airport. They crossed from Normandy, Denmark, Saxony, or Norway in open ships, and they used swords and battle axes as their passports. These descendants of invaders come from right across the British Isles, not just southeast England. Sometime in the Dark Ages, a man called Croc sailed his shallow-keeled ship into the River Trent, and he went as far as he could along the tributaries he chose. I assume he hauled up his ship there and made a homestead. His name probably recalls his fate in battle, suggesting he used a hook for a hand. Hey, you can't win them all. The name of the hamlet he founded suggests this story and his probable Norwegian origin. In the 13th century, most likely, long after the Vikings had stopped raiding England, one of my ancestors left that small village and acquired the name of that village as his surname. He wasn't descended from the owner of the hall. At least he was not in any way an acknowledged heir to any land or title. But then again, the chances that he didn't contain any of that old Viking's blood are just about nil. His descendants remained within 3 or 4 fields of that small village right up until the early 19th century. My grandfather carried that Viking-derived surname, and he had red hair, but not when I knew him. He also used to count his cattle in what sounded like Old Norse to me. It is complete nonsense to suggest that most white British people are, in any meaningful sense, descended from immigrants. The only economic migration which went on was within the British Isles, people dispossessed or escaping famine in Ireland or other Celtic fringes. That describes the heritage of a minority. Even if you are descended from immigrants, does that mean you should in turn welcome more immigrants? No, any more than I should welcome a boatload of Norwegians to come across and rape our women and steal our food. Again, nobody is obliged to welcome immigrants regardless of their family circumstances. Even if their ancestors were themselves fugitives from persecution or dispossessed, or even if they were descended from the greedy imperialist buggers who cleared the highlands to make way for sheep, starved the Irish, and took slaves both black and white across to their plantations in Barbados. Nobody is ever under any obligation to put the interests of other people ahead of the interests of their own family and nation.